Now I guess I'll start off with my talk. So it's wonderful that the majority of you are already aware of the use of data for social good. So I'm pretty relieved because I'm talking to an audience that already understands the whole concept. So I might not need to go entirely from a grassroots level here. Okay, so I think I'll just start off because that I see the votes turning in favor of no right now. So yeah. When we talk about data science, when we read articles or when we come across courses recently, we see a lot of applications and examples that people usually talk about are essentially about how data could be used to improve businesses and probably increase the profitability of certain businesses and generate more value from an economic aspect. Now, that's great because that's what human civilization really runs on. But then there's also another side to data, and, or as I would call it, there are two different wings of it. One is data for business that we are also aware of, and then the other is the data for social good, where we could probably use data and analyze it well enough to provide some level of impact on a social scale to people who really need it. So I shall start off with my talk now. And before getting into the meat of what the whole application was in, with which we use data for social good, I'd first like to introduce the Livin Labs program at Amrita University, because this was the reason why me and my team of five members was able to go all the way to a northern village in India and interact with the people over there and understand their problems and use all our knowledge we had in the data domain and come up with a solution that was sustainable as well as feasible for the villagers in order to transform their lives. So the whole idea of this program, this is the whole idea of the Livin Labs program. So this was just, so I'll be talking about just one particular example or one particular case study that Livin Labs has been doing out of the several case studies they have actually been supporting. So in case you would want to read more about the program, you could go through to this link, which I have passed on in the handouts. And you could probably read it after the session. So now the village of Dornir. So the five-member team that we were, our college is in southern India, and the village that we are talking about here was in northern India. So we had to almost have a cross-country travel, if I could call it that. And this was a three-day journey, and we had to switch two trains throughout this journey. And the journey was definitely arduous and it was difficult, but it was all worth it because the exposure that we received from this village was way more than what we could have ever received within the four walls of a classroom. Now, coming to some basic information about the village to give you an idea of how the village was like, there were around 58 houses in the village, out of which two were dilapidated and did not have human settlement, and there were around 300 plus people. And the major occupation for all the villagers here was unskilled labor. So technically, they were not employed throughout the year, but their employment was pretty much seasonal. So you can already understand the kind of economic instability in which these people were living. Now, before reaching the village, the team was sure of two main things that we had to consider. There would be two primary challenges that we'll have to look at. One was the undeniable gap. Because we were a bunch of city-dwelling kids, and now we had to talk to villagers. So there definitely was going to be a huge gap in our perception of things, our perception of ideas, our communication of certain things. Probably they wouldn't like the way we spoke, and probably we would not understand the way they conveyed in certain regards, because language is also a huge barrier. And then the accepted social conduct. What might be okay for us might not be okay for them. So we had to really factor these human considerations too before we went there. And the second main challenge was the reception to questions. Now, if somebody were to come over to our homes and start asking us questions, and if we felt as if they were interrogating us, things would be really hard. We will really not want to talk to them. We will really not want to answer to them. The only time we answer under compulsion when somebody's talking to us is during the census. So, even if we don't want to do it, we have to do it because that's more or less our responsibility to give the census. But to the villagers, they really didn't have to be obliged to and talk to us. So we had to be really careful about how we dealt with them if we were to help them. So finding the main challenge was what I would be talk is what I'll be talking about next. Now, we were taught in the Live in Labs workshop that there are multiple thematic areas which you should consider when you're talking about rural development. Like you could have education as a problem, you could have water as an issue, you could have waste management, you could have gender equality, skill development, and several others. And most of these are already have already been specified by the United Nations Sustainable Developmental Goals. Our idea here was to identify that one thematic challenge which we could help the village in crossing over so that they could have better lives, so that they could have more improved and more, let's say, more wholesome lives even compared to what they were already living. So the first tool that we used was this very fancy little term called participant observation methodology. Now, if the word sounds too fancy, don't worry, I'll just break it down to you. It's exactly what is depicted by the graphics beneath it. It's all about forming a bond with the community, being a part of them, living the way they live, eating the same food they eat, talking like them, and if possible, even going and playing a game of cricket with the villagers, because cricket's pretty famous in every corner of the country. And by doing this, we also had to understand and observe what the pain points of these people were. And we could use several frameworks. We had a framework where we call the census framework, where I will not really go into the technical details of this because I have written about that in like much more depth in my blog article. But for now, what I would like to leave you here with is that the frameworks such as the census framework or a different framework known as the AEIOU framework, these essentially help you observe the community in a better sense. It helps you gauge more. And after participant observation methodology, we use something known as participatory rural appraisal, which is towards the right of the slide. And this is again a fancy term for all the act for including all the activities beneath it. So when I say resource map, we hand drew a map of the entire village so that we could identify all the resources that the villagers were using and where were these resources placed, if there was wood, at which part of the village was there wood, and if there was a toilet in the village, which is pretty uncommon in a lot of rural settlements. But if there was a toilet in this village, then where would that come? And so on and so forth. So the whole idea was to understand different facets of the village through the participatory rural appraisal. The seasons and activities talk about what do people do at a particular season. The inflow outflow encompass details such as what comes into the village and what goes out of the village. For example, it could either be human beings entering the village for if someone's been married, then it's customary that the bride would come and live with the groom's family. So that's going to be like an inflow to the village, and an outflow would be a person leaving the village for employment. And income and expenditure is pretty self-explanatory. And when we talk about brainstorming with leaders, we are referring to the discussions that we had with the opinion leaders. Now, opinion leaders are those people with some level of power when compared to everybody else in the village. Now, people like listening to these people. So we needed to understand their opinion too on things that we were observing. And finally, the Venn diagram and problem tree and helps you understand which is that one thematic area which requires the most focus in the village. Based on that, we understood that water distribution and water management and non-uniform distribution of it amongst each household in the village was the main concern that we had to be looking at. And based on this, we created personas and scenarios where we tried to empathize with the problems all the villagers had. And when I talk about personas, you can think of it as creating fictional characters with real pain points of multiple people in the experiment. So here our the multiple people encompassed all the villagers. So we grouped villagers based on pain points and created our own fictional characters. And we had three personas, if I remember rightly. One was about auto rickshaw driver who used to drive an auto rickshaw for a living, and if water was late, and if water was late one day, and if he had to go to a distant village to collect water, he would technically lose that much amount of time to drive the auto rickshaw and get money for his family on that particular day. And then the other persona was of a woman who had to work at a household in a different village, but would be late for work every day just because of the water crisis. and therefore again she had a pay cut there. And then the third one was about a teenage girl who during times of during the period of menstruation, she would find it extremely difficult to deal with it when there is severe water crisis. So these were our main personas, and then we created scenarios around it, which was nothing but we mapped the events of these characters in the personas to know where exactly their pain points are. But now we were sure that water management and water distribution was the main challenge, but we still had our own doubts, because what if we were wrong? What if there was something else that was a little more important? Or what if water was not such a big crisis? Because if we were to come back and report to our organization, that is the university, that this is what we found, and now we want the university to go there and probably do something for these people, without objectivity in the report, it would not really sound very credible. So this is where we needed the data science part to get in. This is where we needed to collect data and understand more, so that we will be able to clearly have an objective find whether whatever we decide, whatever we found out through our initial observations were actually right. So now that brings me to conducting our survey. So the first question is, why conduct a survey? So as I had already told you now, it's because we wanted to understand if our results with the participation observation methodology and other allied tools were consistent. And the second part of this is the research question. So if you had to conduct a survey, it was imperative for us to have a very strong research question, because we did not want to be firing blanks into the air. So the question was very simple. Are the people of Dornier suffering from acute water shortage? Apologize for the spelling of suffering there. I do not know how I missed that. But yeah, coming back, the third point that we had to look into was key considerations. So there were four main considerations that we had to be really sure of when we were designing our survey. The first was the relevance. Was each question that we are adding onto our survey relevant? Is it going to help us understand a new facet of the data that we are going to collect? This was extremely important, because we did not have the time to ask too many questions, and asking too many questions with none of the questions giving us credible information is not really helpful. So we had to be very specific in that aspect. And then was the structure. Now, when I talk about structure, I refer to the way how these questions would be asked with the villagers, because we can't just barge into their homes and tell them, okay, this is question number one, I need your answer. Okay, great answer. Now I need for your answer for question number two. It really wouldn't work that way. So we had to structure the questions that we had in the form of a conversation, in the form of an interaction, so that the villagers feel like talking to us. And we also had to translate this in clear, well-written, well-spoken sentences in the local language, because obviously English was not the medium of talking over here, medium of communication over here. So this is also important for us to consider. And then came the length of the questions and length of the survey. Now, people in a village are busy people. They have a lot of things to do. They have their daily chores to do, or even if they do not have much work to do, they will really not appreciate standing next to you and talking to you for like hours and hours. So we had to make things really short and sweet, especially when we were going to their house. So we decided that an interaction will not take more than 10 to 15 minutes, and we will make it as structured as possible, so the villagers really feel happy talking to us about it. And finally, comfort. Even if the questions are only about water usage, sometimes it's not really appropriate to ask any kind of question. So we had to be really sure about that, especially when we are dealing in the rural settlement. So here I'd like to go back to the gap issue, which I talked about at the start of the presentation. So this was another thing that we had to consider. It had to be comfortable for the people to answer, because if we were here to do something for them, the main priority always had to be whether they are comfortable or not. And finally, it was conducting the survey. So how do we conduct the survey? We all woke up one day morning. So we spent like a whole night trying to formulate these questions based on step three. And then we woke up in the morning and we divided ourselves into groups. So we were five of us. We divided ourselves into three groups, and we split ourselves and split all the houses too. So we had like 58 houses. We decided that one cohort's gonna take one house, the other's gonna take the other house. And we divided the entire village for ourselves, and we set up talking to people and understanding. And we wrote down all the details that we had on a sheet of paper. And that's what it looked like. So that's what my copy looked like. Pardon me for the really, really good looking handwriting, but yeah, that's what the original sheet looked like. So we have different fields here. You have the house number, whether it's a tank or sump or neither, that's the storage of water, and the capacity in liters, and does the house use an underground motor or not? And if it does, what are the specifications of it? We didn't really follow up on the specifications after a point, but yeah, that is still there in the sheet. And then the number of people living in the house, and finally the source. T stands for Tharial. Now, Tharial is a distant village from where most of the neighboring villages get their main water supply. And B stands for borewell. So the village has a borewell from where it can take water. But ideally, the people in the village are not supposed to take water from the borewell because there's a huge pending bill of about 1 lakh Indian rupees on that, which the village is yet to pay the government. So again, they were even the water that they were taking from the borewell was something that they're not supposed to be taking. So now I think all of you can gauge the level of problems this village had with related when we are talking about water. And on the left-hand side, you can see the small block diagram of how we conducted the survey. We had a pre-prepared questionnaire, in-person interviews, collected data in handwritten forms, and finally we did digitized it. And when I say digitized, I know it sounds like a very fancy looking cool term, but it's not. We just entered all this onto an Excel sheet, and we did it together so that we do not mess up anywhere when we are when we're converting all this into a more digital format. And now I'll come to performing data analysis, which is like my main, which is where I mainly step in. So if you look at the top right corner, you can see a small snapshot of our data set. This is the pandas data frame essentially. So to those of you who are aware of what a pandas data frame is, you would know that. And to those of you who are not, you don't need to worry. It's just a fancy name for a table right now, so you can consider it like that. So the fields again are pretty similar to the fields that we had in the handwritten data. The fields just look a little more well organized now. Now, if you look carefully at the capacity feature, which is talking about liters, numbers, you see that you have numbers such as 512 at the within the same field. Now, that does not mean 500 liters and 12 liters. When the choice of storage is tank, the capacity is in liters, so it's 500 liters. But when the choice of storage is in buckets, it's not liters, it's in the number, it's the count of buckets, so it's 12 buckets. So what we had to do was we had to clean our data set in such fashion that if it's a bucket, we had to multiply 12 with 30, if I'm not wrong. Okay, not 30, I think 20, if I'm not wrong, considering that one bucket could have 20 liters. So 12 into 20, 240 liters. That is the storage for that particular feature. So this came in our data cleaning aspect. Now, at the bottom of the screen, you can see a small little flowchart here. So this should be really easy for all of you to understand, and I'll try and make it a little more simpler. So first, we have a questionnaire which is used to conduct the survey, and then we have the handwritten survey data which is passed on to loading data, and by loading data, I mean converting it into an Excel sheet and all that. And that particular data becomes survey data, and it's passed into this beautiful little black box or a gray box in this case called data cleaning. So I just told you about the capacity anomaly where tank and buckets have separate scales itself of how they are measured. So the data cleaning involves a lot of issues such as this. For example, you could have values in different scales, or you could have inconsistencies in your values and all that. And data cleaning is a very huge problem because data cleaning ends up skewing the final results and probably gives you a wrong understanding of the whole picture. So once we took care of data cleaning, the next thing I had to do was feature engineering. So each of these columns that you see in your data set are known as features. So obviously, when we say feature engineering, you can think of it like creating a new column with existing columns. So here, the new column that I had to create was the number of the amount of water each person in a household received, because we have the features of total water a house gets in a day. And we also have the feature of the number of people in the household. So if you were to divide the capacity divided by number of people, we would get the amount of water each person in the household gets per day. Now, I know there is a serious underlying assumption that every person in the household will use the same kind of will use the same amount of water. But considering that we do not have a lot of children in the village, and considering that we do not have a lot of children in the village, and that we are looking at an entirely different metric, which I'll come to at the end, this assumption seemed totally okay to go with. And after feature engineering, we had our complete data, and then I visualized the data and came up with some really important insights that kind of blew our minds when we came to it at the end. So water consumption in the village. The first graph you see on the left talks about the storage mediums in the village, and we see that most of the households use buckets as a storage medium, and then we had tanks as a storage medium, then cans, sump, and a miscellaneous format. And so the main medium of storage of storing water in the village was buckets. So that's cool. Now let's move on to the second graph. So second graph is a distribution plot of the water per person per day in the village. So we can see that this is a very thick graph when it comes to the left-hand side, and that huge thick portion lies after between 0 to 50 liters, and then it tapers down towards 100. There's a small camel hump before reaching 150, and then there's a plateau like at a probability of zero, and then you have a small little mountain between 150 and 200. And so the main thing to understand from this graph is that the major amount of people get water only between that 0 to 100 liters area, and people getting water after that is just a relative rarity. Now, if this graph kind of blew your mind, let me come to something else which is gonna definitely blow your mind a little more. The graph on the left. So we kind of factored in a metric what the United Nations has suggested, that if somebody's got to be living their daily lives with having enough amount of water so that no health emergencies will arise, then you need at least 50 liters of water for that person per day. So we tried and to factorize that into our data over here, and we realized that the households meeting UN's water requirement, where every person in the household got at least 50 liters of water, which is the threshold over here. If you are going to consider this metric, 2/3 of the houses in the village did not meet this requirement, did not meet United Nations water requirement. Only 1/3 of it met. So that's like only 33% of people in the whole village who were having their basic needs met, and the others did not have it met. And then we checked about the motor impact. Does motor actually impact water availability? And that's where we have this plot, this nice looking box plot on the right-hand side. Okay, I do not know if it's nice looking. I'll let you be the judge of that. But the whole idea of this plot is to show that on an average, when we are going to take up an average as a scale here, the number of people who, the houses that actually use an underground motor to collect water, on an average get way more water than the houses that do not employ a motor. Now, you might ask me, why is this a problem? It's okay, right? If why can't all the houses get motors? Now, this is where I would like to break it to you that according to what we heard from the municipal corporation or the government authority of Punjab, basically, that using underground motors in the villages to collect water is illegal. They're not supposed to be doing that. So we have a set of houses who are actually breaking the rules and ending up getting more than what they should actually be getting, and therefore not letting other houses get it because these houses are breaking the rules. So now this was not just a data concern, this was not just a water concern, this was more of a societal concern, and this is where we needed more policies to be used. This is where we needed the panchayat, which is the governing body of the village, to understand the difference and probably come up with a better policy to make sure that it's more of a level playing field for all the people involved, or all the people in the village, basically. So now what I would like to tell you here is that we started off with a developmental program for the village, and we came across a cause, we came across a problem which we felt was the main problem over there. And then we found out ways to identify this problem, and then we started using data science in order to see and corroborate if our finds were actually correct, and whether we could go ahead with what we had in our hand. So the data science lookout here taught me three main things. First, it confirmed what we found out. It told us that whatever we found was true. Second, it showed us much more because we did not know about the meeting UN's water requirement. We never quantified the water usage people had. And there was no way we would have realized about how motor impacts water availability had we not looked at this from the aspect of data science. And the last one, it helped us build a highly objective report with actionable insights. Because now when we went back and we submitted a report to the university, we were not asking them to do something based on intuition or based something on subjective study. We had very objective finds, and all our finds were really covered up with actionable insights. So we knew exactly what had to be done by the university and what had to be done by organizations in order to improve the lives of people here. And if any of you would like to know a bit more about this project, and if you'd like to see the code that I had written behind this, you could go over to my GitHub portfolio. It's passed with your handout, so you could go to the repository and understand more about the code used and even see the data set. And if you could pick up the data set, it's a very small data set, but if you could pick it up and find out a new insight in that, it would be super cool, and we would probably get that across to our organization too. And I had written a 17-minute article on this on Towards Data Science, which is a Medium publication. So if you're interested in going into the nitty-gritty details, and in case you feel I missed a point somewhere, you could probably read that article, because I have given a very comprehensive outlook in that particular piece. And finally, this is the team. These were the five of us who were responsible for whatever I had just talked about. So it was great. So it would have not been possible to do any of this without them. And also my mentor, who's not there in this picture. So we also had a teacher to be our mentor when we went all the way to the village. And yeah, we were a mix of multiple branches, just like Livin Labs program had initially promised that it's going to be multidisciplinary. All of us came from different backgrounds, and I was the only CSE student. And when I started off, that was a bit of a turn off, but then later on data came across and I was happy again. And finally, if any of you would like to have any questions, if there's anything you would like to ask me, I'm more than happy to take it. So I think I have a few questions here. I have a question from Jagatpati where he's asking me, so before we set out solving a problem, making sure we have an accurate identification and the definition of a problem through data gathering surveys, the last thing we want is to solve the wrong problem. Is this at the heart of data analytics? Okay, so the question Jagatpati wants to ask me is whether understanding the problem that we are trying to solve and having an entire idea of the whole picture before trying to solve the wrong problem, whether this is what is at the heart of data analytics. And I think that should be, but then if I'm going to kind of broaden and give you a more broad answer to that, I think that's the heart of engineering itself, right? Because I come from an engineering background, so pardon me if I like talk a little towards the engineering side, but the whole idea of engineering is to come up with really viable solutions to problems, right? So the first thing you should do and the most important thing to do would be to understand whether you have an accurate identification of what you want to do. Else, like I told, it will be you're going to be firing shots, you're going to be firing blank shots into the air, and that's really not going to help anybody, right? So based on your question, yes, that should be at the heart of any data-related endeavor, because data is responsibility, right? So, and like Uncle Ben once said, with great power comes great responsibility. So data scientists, we are super responsible people, and we have to be, right? So I think I've answered your question there. And do I have any more questions? I'll be really happy to take any more if there is any more.
So when there's little questions that come in, this is generally reflective of the quality of talk, because you've answered most people's questions. And if anybody else wants to pop any more questions in there, I think we may have one more there.
No, okay. It's just a response to the previous question. So I think we are good to go. So I think I'll transfer the control back to you, Stephen. And if anybody has any questions, you can just ping me on the chat box. I'll be here till the end of the talk and we could have a discussion. And please take your handouts. You can connect with me because I've provided you all the links in the handouts. I would be really, really excited to like build my knowledge and build new connections. So thanks a lot for being a wonderful audience, everybody. Thank you.